Well, welcome to Chapter 3 of Criminal Law here, and we're in the spring semester of 2024 here at Wake Tech. This class is Criminal Law. You may be listening to it slightly later, next year or so, but we're using the same textbook if you're reading this, listening to it. So we're going to talk about essential elements of crime. General background to this idea is that all crimes, no matter what we're talking about, very minor crimes like jaywalking or very important or critical crimes like homicide can be broken down into smaller constituent parts, both individual parts in kind of reality and also some individual parts in subjective reality. That'll become a little bit clearer in a moment. Okay, so one second here. I'm doing a little bit of an issue. Don't worry too much about the learning objectives here. We're going to go ahead and talk about, instead, we're going to begin conviction of crime. So when we talk about the elements of crime, so let's take a crime, a simple crime like burglary in North Carolina. So North Carolina will say, depending upon the degree of burglary, that you broke and entered, those are two separate things, into a residence or a dwelling home. Can be a time of day, a night makes it a more serious offense, with the intent typically to commit a larceny inside or a serious felony. So you'll notice that each one of those is a separate thing. I'm going to have to prove, if I'm the prosecutor, the breaking, the entering, that I had the intent to commit a larceny inside, that it was a dwelling house that I broke in order for it to be a burglary. If I can't prove each and every one of those elements, perhaps some other crime occurred. Maybe I broke in to a neighbor's house not to commit a felony, but to commit an act of voyeurism. I broke in to watch her do something, or maybe I broke in to just trespass, to walk around his house for some reasons. So I have to prove, when I'm the prosecutor, beyond a reasonable doubt, that each and every one of these elements occurred. That they were committed by the person on trial, if we're talking about a criminal trial. Now, civil trial, there is a lower level of proof necessary, because if you think about it, the stakes there are a little less serious. If you're convicted criminally, you go to prison. If you're convicted civilly, usually all that happens is you pay a fine or there's some sort of injunction issued. All right, so we look at the essential elements of crime, and some analysis can break this into different parts, and usually you'll hear them say there are two kind of physical parts, really one physical, one mental part, and then the unity of them. So let me jump in and make that a little bit clearer, because that seems murky. So the first thing that has to be proved is that the physical act occurred. So let's go back to our burglary example, and let's just talk about one of the elements, that you entered. So in other words, if I broke a window, but I didn't go inside the house, the prosecution would be unable to prove that I actually entered the house. So the actus reus are the physical acts that compose the crime. Now the second part of this, which isn't as much physical, is what's called mens re, which is Latin meaning the guilty mind. So let's go back to our example. Let's suppose I was drunk and believed that I was entering my own house, and I couldn't get in, so I forced the door. I broke in. Well, the prosecution would be able to prove the physical act, but they'd be unable to prove the mens re, the guilty mind, that I did it with the intent to commit the crime. If I did something by accident, it's less serious, less worthy of punishment than if I did something intentionally. That's also sometimes where you begin to see a word called sinitor, which is a really good word. And sinitor is the requirement that you have unified these two things, that you've committed the physical act and that you knew it was wrong when you did it. Now, merely thinking about things, not crimes. Right. You might think, oh man, that guy cut me off in traffic. I'd like to ram his car. But thinking about something like that doesn't make it a crime. There are some crimes, however, that we don't really look at, did you intend to do it? So burglary has a requirement of mens rea, that you must intend to break in, right? Can't be accidental. But a crime like speeding, we don't care what you were thinking. If the police clock you doing 70 in a 55, and your defense is, oh, I'm sorry, I just didn't notice, I wasn't paying attention, I didn't have the guilty mind, that is not a defense to that type of crime. So there are some crimes that are categorized as strict liability crimes. We don't care what you were thinking. There are other crimes that, yeah, what you were thinking is really important. Now, the final distinction is not really an element of crime. Is it a crime of commission or is it a crime of omission? Most crimes are crimes whereby you do something. So, I stabbed the man. I shot the woman. I burned down the house. So, you do something there. But suppose I simply watched someone get shot. I watched someone get stabbed. I saw someone burn down a church and didn't act to stop them. Typically, a failure to act is not a crime. There are a small category of crimes where we say, yeah, it matters. It does matter. You had a duty to act, you didn't act, and that constitutes a crime. Quick example there would be, you have a child. The child needs food, the child needs medical care, the child is in danger, and you don't act to save it from the danger, to feed it, or take it to the doctor, and the child is injured because of that. And the child isn't an independent agency, it can't operate by itself, or themselves. The result of which is you can be charged with child abuse because you failed to act. Most crimes are crimes of commission. A few crimes are crimes of omission. All right, let's talk about this forbidden act. A crime is an intentional act or, in rare cases, an omission. It has to happen in reality. It can't be a thought. It can't be a desire. There are different people that come into play. Now, there is the actual person who did the physical crime. So let's suppose I decide I want to kill my wife, and I hire a hitman to do it, and he goes and he kills my wife. The hitman obviously committed the crime, okay? So he would be chargeable. But what about me? I didn't do the physical act. Well, we're going to have the ability to charge me as well, because typically we will have a charge called conspiracy if the crime usually doesn't go forward, or accessory if the crime goes forward. So let's suppose I hire a hitman to kill my wife. The police find out about this before the crime occurs, but we had gotten together, formed an agreement, I had paid him money to do this. I would be chargeable with conspiracy to commit murder. If I had actually gone out and bought him a gun or given him a key to the house, I would have aided and assisted him in the commission of this crime. So I would usually be called an accessory, in this case usually an accessory before the fact. Now there's also accessories after the fact. In some situations, again, there are crimes of omission. A failure to act can constitute a criminal offense. And sometimes it's a little murky. So let's suppose there is this is kind of a classic case. A mother who has a child, and there is someone in the house, let's call him a stepfather, who is beating the child with no reason. That person is committing the crime, and it's going to be a crime in different states called different things, but we'll just say it is an assault on a child, usually a felony. We'll say it's an assault inflicting serious injury. Let's suppose that this child beater puts out a child's eye. Because the mother is present and aware of this, she has a duty to step in, to stop him. And if she doesn't step in, if she just says, well, you know, these are the things that happen, oh well, or I don't want to get in there because I'll get beat or someone will put out my eye, she is chargeable as some type of accessory to this crime. Okay, so these are all failures to act. Here are some classic examples of this. Failure to report the death of a child. Now, this is, you know, raising some really interesting questions with this rollback of abortion rights in the United States. I just saw a case, I believe it was out of Texas, it might have been Ohio, where they have a fairly strict statute against abortion. This woman suffered a miscarriage. She didn't report the miscarriage, and there was a debate whether she was going to be charged. So she had a duty to come forward, and her failure to act, an omission, was potentially chargeable. Do you have a duty to come forward and say, okay, I suffered a miscarriage? Do you have to report that to the police? If you fail to report the location of a human corpse, if you came across a corpse or a body in the woods, you have a positive duty in many states to report that to the police. Here's one I was kind of talking about earlier. Failure by a parent or guardian to provide adequate food, clothing, shelter, or medical care to a child under their care. Now, most of the time, you're talking about a parent here. Rarely, okay, we're talking about someone that is in a position of authority, a substitute position. Usually, you sometimes see the Latin term in loco parentis, or as a guardian of the child. Failure to submit to a breathalyzer or a similar test when lawfully requested to do so by the police. This can either be civil or criminal omissions. So the police officer says, okay, I pulled you over. I did a field sobriety test. I believe you're intoxicated. I want you to blow in this breathalyzer, and you say no. In some jurisdictions, that constitutes a crime. In other jurisdictions, there are civil penalties established for it, like loss of license in North Carolina, sometimes for a year or more. But it's up to the states. They'll do that. Failure of one involved in an accident to remain at the scene of the crime. And again, this is a fairly obvious one. You're in an accident. Maybe it wasn't a criminal accident. You're driving. A small child rushes out in the front of you in the street. It's completely the child's fault. You hit the child. The child is injured. You see this, and you leave. Well, you were involved in the accident. You have a duty to remain there. And if you don't, it's a crime. It's going to be a hit and run, typically. But interestingly enough, let's remove this just a little bit. Let's suppose you were a bystander. You're walking down the street. You see a small child run out in the street. You see a driver hit the child, and the child is injured or killed. And you say, wow, that's really horrible, but I'm late for work, so I'm leaving. And you walk away. You have not committed a crime. You don't have to stay there and cooperate. Homicide by omission is killing someone by failing to take an act. Usually there is a relationship there that's involved. Failure to act if a person is in a contractual agreement and the person is harmed. So you're the guy that's supposed to tighten the bolts on the bungee jumping machine or one of those big swings in an amusement park, and you just don't do it. And that person is injured. Your failure to act there could result in a criminal charge. Okay, mens rea is the guilty mind. And most criminal codes, including the North Carolina Criminal Code, look at the state of mind of the person that did it. Now, people often kind of skip this step. I find this very common among students where they say, well, who cares what they're thinking? Well, it's actually vitally important. Because think about the difference between killing someone negligently, you had an accident, you weren't paying attention, and killing someone purposely. And that's going to be the difference between, in classic first-degree murder, premeditated murder, you know, I want to kill Bob, therefore I'm going to poison his coffee. or negligently. Hey, I was making the coffee, I wasn't paying attention, and some antifreeze got in because I was making it in a garage. I don't know, I'm making something up. So in the first case, it's going to be a first-degree murder charge. If you're convicted of it, in a lot of states, we can kill you. In the last case, it's a negligence, and it may not even be serious enough to warrant a criminal charge. So most criminal codes require that the physical acts have some guilty mind associated with them. And there are different degrees. And usually, the more purposely you do something, the more intentionally you commit the crime, the worse the crime is. You kill someone because you're negligent, it may or may not be a crime, but if it's a crime, it's going to be a minor one. We have in North Carolina, for example, misdemeanor death by motor vehicle. You're driving a car, you make a simple negligent mistake, and someone is killed. We also have a first-degree murder charge. You're driving a car, you see someone you hate, you steer the car directly for them, you run them over. That's going to be the difference between a misdemeanor charge, which you easily could serve no time in jail for, and a felony charge whereby you could, again, be executed yourself. So that's the range. Did you do it negligently, or were you reckless? Now, that's a little bit worse. It's not just, oh, I heard the phone ring, I was distracted for a second, looked down, and I ran over the child. That's terrible. That's negligent. But let's take it a little step up. Still, maybe not as intentional. So I was speeding down the street, and my license was expired, and I hadn't slept in 20 hours, and I closed my eyes, and I ran over the child. And then there's knowingly and purposely, and you can see how that becomes more and more important. Okay. North Carolina and mens rea. Let's talk a little bit about mens rea. North Carolina recognizes different types. In most cases, you've got to prove in North Carolina that someone acted willfully or maliciously. If you can't do that, usually in North Carolina we say you acted negligently or the crime was a crime of negligence. It's not always the case, but the easiest way to think about this is if you can show that someone in North Carolina did something willfully or maliciously, and maliciously is defined in North Carolina as something with in ill will or hatred, that you did something basically because you're evil, that's going to be a felony. If you did something negligently, most of the time or often, that's going to be a misdemeanor, a much less serious crime. Okay, so this scale, I think, is somewhat helpful. And you'll see where if you just committed a very minor piece of negligence, it's usually not criminal. So you're driving a car, a child runs out in the road, you hit the brakes, you slide a little bit, and you hit him. The child is injured but not killed. The police come and they find that one of your tires was a little bit bald. Some of the tread had worn off. Not completely, just a little bit. You might get a ticket, or you're going to be civilly sued for the civil negligence, but you're not going to jail. Criminal negligence is that next degree higher from there. Then we go to reckless, then we go to knowing, and then we go to the worst of the worst, the highest degree of mental fault. This is where you have the specific intent to do things. You do it intentionally. You do it willfully. You do it purposely. Or in North Carolina, you do it maliciously with ill will or hatred. And usually, as we go up this chart, each crime becomes more serious. Okay. Some different types of mens rea to keep talking about that. Specific intent is when you desired the act that happened. And this links the mental state to what went on. So did you have the specific intent to kill someone? And sometimes this is just obviously presumed. You take a gun, you point the gun at someone, you pull the trigger, you have the specific intent to kill them. You might say, well, maybe I wasn't going to kill him, maybe I was going to shoot him in the foot or something. It doesn't matter. Now, general intent can show you don't have the specific intent to do things, but you should have known better what you're doing. Sometimes I take a gun, I point it at someone. I'm a very poor shot. I pull the trigger, or the gun goes off, and the bullet goes out the window and hits a bystander. You didn't have the specific intent to kill him, but you had the general intent to pull the trigger. This is not stressed a lot, but usually you're going to be chargeable with a crime. Maybe not the crime of first-degree murder, although we have a doctrine called transferred intent in North Carolina. You have to prove, if it's part of the crime and you're the prosecutor, you have to prove this intent beyond a reasonable doubt. All right, some exceptions to mens rea. First and foremost, the United States Supreme Court has never created or announced a doctrine requiring that you prove mens rea in all crimes. And states have been free, and they have used that freedom, to not require mens rea in some serious crime. So, down here are some examples. And this first one is probably how most homicides are charged. And this is the felony murder rule. We kind of have the idea that, I think this is because of the fiction we watch on TV, murders, or the books we read. And very often people have a premeditation. So you can have an Agatha Christie or someone pushes a gargoyle over on someone as they're walking into a castle during a thunderstorm because they want to kill them. That's a freakishly rare crime. So how do crimes really occur? Well, we have something in North Carolina called the felony murder or the murder felony doctrine that says, were you committing a felony? Did someone die during that felony? You're charged with first degree murder. We don't have to prove that you intended to kill anybody. We just have to show that you were part of this nexus of behavior. So, quick example of this. Fred gets his friend to go down to the liquor store. He tells his friend, hey, we're going to rob the liquor store. And his friend is waiting outside. Guy goes in, sticks up the liquor store. The clerk panics. The robber panics, fires the gun, kills the clerk, runs out to the car. They drive away. Under the felony murder doctrine or the murder felony doctrine, can be used interchangeably either way, obviously the guy that pulled the trigger, since he committed the murder during the felony, is chargeable, but so is the driver. We also have crimes that are strict liability crimes. We don't care what you were thinking. We also have crimes that we don't look at your mental state. We just look, did you actually possess something? Probably the most commonly charged here is drug possession. Oh, did you, want to possess this? Do I have to prove you intentionally possess this? No, if I caught you with cocaine, it's possession of cocaine. All right, sinitor, which is this knowledge. In lots of crimes, there's a requirement that you have actual knowledge of wrongdoing. And this term, sinitor, is a very useful term. It's the distinction between what you have to know and the knowledge that what you were doing was bad. So sometimes it's really requiring that you have this kind of evil intent, the sinitor, this knowledge that what you're doing was wrong. It's not that you were just merely mistaken. It's not that you, if I take a coat and I really believe the coat is mine, if I hung up a coat at a restaurant and I take the coat and it turns out there were two identical coats and I took the wrong coat, I don't have any sinitor. But if I go in and it's raining and I say, hey, I don't want to get wet, I'm just going to take this coat, I have sinitor. I know that I don't own that coat. I'm intentionally taking it. Usually sinitor makes a crime worse. All right, so where do we need it? The first one is an interesting one. In an assault on a law enforcement officer, knowledge that the victim is a law enforcement officer. This is interesting because if you think about police officers who break into a home, maybe they're serving a warrant, maybe they're trying to rescue someone, maybe they're trying to arrest someone. Have they identified themselves first? So you're lying in bed, you hear someone break down the door. Nobody says, hey, police officers. They just break down the door and you shoot at them. Now, the state might like to prosecute you saying, okay, you committed in North Carolina assault with a deadly weapon on law enforcement, or whatever the specific statute we'd be looking at. because it's a more serious crime to shoot at a police officer than it is to shoot at a regular person. Your defense would be, I didn't know that it was a cop. It was just someone breaking down my door. One that can be charged is refusing to aid a law enforcement officer with knowledge that the person requesting it is a police officer or law enforcement officer. This is not one I'm very familiar with because I don't believe it exists in North Carolina. Certainly there are going to be real limits to this, but the state could prosecute it. Receiving stolen property. This is one that I am somewhat familiar with, having practiced law. Let's suppose your son comes home and says, hey, I found this, make up some minor object, I found this baseball in the street. I'm going to keep it. Would you hold on to it for me, Dad? And he throws it to me. And I take it and I put it in the, I put it in his room, or I put it in my room, or I put it in the hall, it doesn't matter. Did I know that that was stolen? Let's suppose my son had stolen that baseball. Well, I've received stolen property at this point, but I didn't know. So I couldn't be charged with it. On the other hand, let's suppose my son, who's, say, 14, comes home and he's got a Corvette, a brand new Corvette, and he says, hey, I found this. Can I park it in the garage, Dad? And I say, sure, great. Now we got a Corvette you found on the street. Well, do I directly know he stole it? No, but it's going to be impossible to deny it. So I'm going to be chargeable along with my son with the idea of being an accessory to this. The last one, which usually in North Carolina is called accessory after the fact, but the example here on the text is harboring or aiding a felon, knowledge that that person is a felon. So someone knocks on your door and say, hey, my car broke down. Do you have a spare tire, or do you have a jack I can use to change it? And you know, you go in your garage, you say, sure, here's a jack. Guy changes his tire, drives away. Police show up later and say, hey, we were chasing this guy. Did he knock on the door? And you say, yes, somebody knocked on the door and they asked for a tire and I helped him. Oh, this guy just robbed a bank. He was running away. You know, you helped him. Well, I didn't know he was a felon. He was just some guy that broke down and I was trying to be a good Samaritan. You're probably not chargeable there because you didn't know. You don't have sinister. On the other hand, someone knocks on the door. They've got an axe in their hand, and they've got blood spatter all over them, and they've got a 100-yard stare, and they're looking at you going, I need to get away. Can I borrow your jack? My car has a flat. Well, you know something is wrong here. If you go ahead and give him help, you are an accessory after the fact. You have harbored or aided a felon. And usually the language in North Carolina reads escaping detection or even escaping arrest. All right, sinister can be introduced using the proper language. So we'll read this actual slide because I think it's somewhat helpful. If a statute states that the crime is, quote, wrongfully introduced drugs to a military institution, then the prosecution has to show that you knew you were introducing drugs to it. So did someone just give you a package and say, hey, my son, you know, works at Camp Lejeune, take this package down to him if you will. And you say, oh, sure, no problem. On the other hand, if someone gives you a package and it reeks of marijuana and says, hey, would you take this down there? You're willfully blind. And the Supreme Court will say, in analyzing, did you or did you not have sinister, did you not have this knowledge, were you willfully blind to it? Did you take a deliberate act not to learn what was going on? In such case, you have a strict liability issue, and we can charge you. Okay, a couple cases here from the Supreme Court, the Gibson and Bailey case. United States versus Gibson Company, United States Supreme Court stated that in the case of most crimes, quote, the limited distinction between knowledge and purpose has not been considered important. Following up on that, the United States and Bailey said, the court said, in a general sense, purpose means specific intent, and knowledge means general intent. Usually, it doesn't matter that too much. It's still a crime if I shoot the gun to kill you, I have the specific intent, or if I shoot the gun with the general intent to intimidate. Both of those are going to be sufficient mens rea. All right, now motive. If you read the criminal law, motive is very often not there. So if you read the first degree murder statute in North Carolina, unless you read it in a particular way and you kind of stretched it, there's no mention of motive. But if you're trying to convict someone of murder in North Carolina and you're the prosecutor, you're very often going to have to show a motive. So if someone gets charged with murder, you're going to have to go to the jury and say, this is why he did it. You're going to have to show how he did it. You're going to have to show the individual elements. You're going to have to show that he intentionally did it. But you're going to have to show why. Because, you know, most of us think, well, someone wouldn't kill someone without a pretty good reason. If you tell me this person just killed him randomly, that this was an outstanding citizen who was, you know, never in trouble for 50 years, and all of a sudden he just killed someone out of the blue, and that's what you're claiming, I don't buy it. So let's see that motive. Motive is not usually an element, but it is usually required to get a conviction. So it's kind of a hidden element. Okay. Here are some of the different elements that may be essential to the proof of the crime. Now, obviously, we have the actus reus, the physical acts, because thinking about things aren't bad. You have the mens rea. You may require sinitor, or as a substitute, possession, or there can be statutes that are unique. You know, proof of harm done, proof of the age of the victim, other essential elements required by statute. All right, let's switch and talk about strict liability crimes. The easiest way, I think, to think of strict liability crimes is speeding. All of us have looked down driving a car, and you know, maybe we see a sign that says 35 miles an hour, and we zoom by it, and we look at our speedometer, and oh my gosh, we're driving 50 or 55 or 60. We didn't intend to break the law, but we were breaking the law. We are not going to be able to have a system of traffic control if anyone that we pulled over for driving 55 and a 35 would be able to say, hey, I just didn't know. You've got to prove, Senator, you've got to prove that I intended to speed. Instead, we're going to say we're not going to require intent. We're only going to require the physical acts. Now, of course, most of the time, we don't think of these people as traditional criminals. It's just kind of, oh, you were a little bit careless. Sometime we do. Let me give you an example, because I think this slide is a little misleading. Let's suppose that someone has sex with an individual, and the person, let's suppose he's a 25-year-old male, and he has sex with an individual, a woman, and it turns out he doesn't know this, but that woman is underage, say 15. She might look like she's 20, but he has sex with her and she's 15. It is not a defense for him to say, I didn't know, I didn't have sinitor. It is a strict liability crime if you sleep with someone who's underage. Now, you'll notice that you might have a little bit more sympathy for someone who says, well, the person looked 20. But you're probably not going to have a crime saying, but he still needs to go to jail if he's sleeping with a 15-year-old. However, you're still going to think in the issue of statutory rape that that is a traditional criminal, maybe with a little leeway. All right, so here are some examples of strict liability laws. Traffic laws are strict liability, liquor sale laws, hunting laws, purity of food, laws protecting children, laws on narcotics, all those are strict liability. You got dope on you, you've got a possession charge. You know, you were speeding, you're going to get a speeding ticket. North Carolina, quick example, statutory rape, I just kind of explained it. Possession of a handgun on educational property. You drive your, you know, you were out hunting, and I don't know why you'd have a handgun, but you were at the shooting range. Okay, practicing with your handgun, you have a right to have the handgun. You don't have a concealed carry permit, and you drive onto the campus of a college or a school. You might say, well, oh, you know, I forgot I had the pistol. Well, too bad. It's possession of a handgun on educational property. You're chargeable. Strict liability crimes, sometimes we call these regulatory crimes. I think that's true for a lot of them, but you know, if you look at something like statutory rape, I don't think you'd call that a regulatory crime. But knowledge that the act was unlawful is not important. The state does not have to prove your mental state. So North Carolina doesn't have to prove you thought about this. They just have to prove under a strict liability crime that the elements happened. Okay, some other material elements. The requirement that a forbidden act causes it. Now, this can raise some interesting questions. Let's suppose I push someone down and they fall on the ground and they cut themselves. That's a fairly common occurrence. Traditionally, that would be assault, maybe assault inflicting serious injury, maybe assault just inflicting injury. But let's suppose, unbeknownst to me, that when that guy falls, he breaks a rib. Okay, a year later, that rib is still loose, and it, when he rolls over or something, it causes cardiac event and he dies. So from that assault where I push someone over intentionally to his death, there's 6 months. Am I responsible for the homicide? And this is a causation problem because there can be substantial time gaps between the criminal act and the death of the victim. Now traditionally what we did was we said if someone doesn't die within a year, sometimes you'll hear a year and a day, between the event occurring and when the person dies, then we're not going to charge the homicide. That's kind of gone out the window. I saw a recent case in North Carolina where it had been years since someone had engaged in abuse of a child. That child has grown up, and about 10 years later or so, that child died. The individual who committed the child abuse was charged with a homicide 10 years after the fact. All right, let's talk a little bit about presumptions and inferences, which are two different things. Presumptions are facts that are presumed because of other facts. Sometimes we call these predicated facts. Inferences are permissible. So one of the common inferences is that you desire the natural consequences of your act. If you pull the trigger of a gun, you're hoping the gun goes off and the bullet comes out the end. You can't pull the trigger and go, hey, look at that, that's amazing, who knew that a gun fired like that? No, it's certainly presumed almost, that, or it's an inference that it commonly occurs. We're going to assume that everybody is sane. We're going to assume that everybody is competent. Now, inferences can be overturned. So let's go to the sane and competent one, because that's a something that the general public have some issues with. We presume that everybody is sane. Sanity is a delicate thing to talk about. It's a legal concept, not a medical concept. So a doctor might give you a diagnosis that someone is a schizophrenic, or someone is depressive, or someone is bipolar. But then the question becomes, well, is that a serious enough mental illness that they are now insane? We are going to presume, there's an inference, that you are sane. And we're going to have to prove, okay, that you are insane in order to overcome this inference, the defense is. Okay, this is that year and a day murder rule I talked about. A death of a victim must occur within a year and a day of a crime for it to be caused. Now, this has been challenged by lots of states. And like I said, North Carolina has abandoned this. Really because I think our science has gotten better. Most states have either by statute or court decisions abolished this. There is a Supreme Court case, Rogers versus Tennessee in 2001. The Supreme Court held that retroactive, which means after the fact application, are violations of due process only when they're unexpected or indefensible. So let's suppose that there was in Tennessee, and I believe there was at this point in 2001, a year and a day rule, and someone dies, and the Tennessee says, well, we got rid of the year and a day rule in 1999, and the defense says, yeah, but I committed the, let's suppose it's someone hurts a child and the child dies 5 years later. I hurt this child 5 years before in 1995. You can't retroactively apply that. The Supreme Court said, yeah, we can. So by and large, that murder, that year and a day rule is gone. It's certainly gone in North Carolina. Let's talk a little bit about possession. All states make possession of certain objects crimes. Now, there's two ways in which you can possess something, or the law says. One is what we call actual. It's in your purse. It's in your wallet. It's in your pants. It's in your pocket. It's on you. Then there's also constructive. I go into your house where you live. I go to your nightstand. In your nightstand is cocaine. You didn't have that physically on you. It wasn't actual, but it was constructive. Possession means you owned it. I don't have to prove ownership, but it really is one of the parts of ownership. This is, yeah, probably, I'm trying to think of one of those common places. This is commonly charged when people are stopped in automobiles. They search the automobile. They don't find the cocaine or the marijuana or the heroin or the fentanyl in their pockets, but they might find it somewhere in the passenger compartment. You're going to charge all the passengers. They might have found it in the trunk. You're going to charge everybody. All right, so presumptions. What are presumptions? Well, there are mandatory presumptions and there are optional presumptions, I guess we could give us both. But mandatory presumptions are what we say are irrefutable. That if you've got a mandatory presumption, you can't change it. Sometimes if these are against the defendant, they are violations of due process. Because what you're trying to do is you're trying to say to the prosecution, you don't have to prove this fact. Presumption of innocent until proven guilty is what we call a rebuttable presumption, which means, yeah, we will presume you're innocent. But the day that we convict you, that presumption is gone. You have a presumption of sanity. Okay, this is kind of on the other foot. We're going to presume everybody is sane. But if you provide enough evidence that you're insane, that is no longer a presumption. Presumption of innocence places the burden of proof on the prosecution. The way they overcome this presumption of innocence is they prove each and every element of the crime beyond a reasonable doubt. Kind of self-explanatory there. All right, these here at the end, there's a few thinking points. These are things you can, you know, look at. What charges a prosecution bring depends upon the facts surrounding a case. Some of these facts are directly related to the crime. Some of them are more tangentially related. In each of the following situations, relates to a vehicle injury, a person dies. You decide if and what charges should be brought against it. After reading each scenario, you would discuss the actus reus, the mens rea, and the scenario for each, and what the charge should be. So let's take a look at them quickly. Okay. A man suspects his wife is having an affair. He grabs a camera and his gun and follows her. He finds her leaving a man's home. She's walking to his car. He aims the car at her. He accelerates. He runs her over, kills her. He goes home, goes to bed. Okay. So in this case, the bare facts are a man driving a car, runs over a woman, and kills her. Okay, so they're the elements. But we're going to look at the sinister there. You know, did he intend to do it? He sure did. Do you have evidence that he intended to do it? Yeah, he took a camera, a gun, he followed her, he aimed the car at her. Okay, so this is going to be a first-degree murder charge in this scenario. we're going to be able to charge him, and I'm going to refer to North Carolina because that's what I'm most familiar with, we're going to charge him with a first-degree murder. Scenario two, a man has had three heart attacks, and as a precaution, his cardiologist says, you shouldn't drive. Your driver's license should be revoked. However, he needs to get some cigarettes, and he decides he's going to drive down there. He drives to the convenience store. He has a heart attack while he's driving. He loses control of the car, hits another driver. That driver dies. Now, contrast that with the first one. It's not as evil. But it's not simple negligence, is it? Remember when we looked at the negligence, we said there's like simple negligence where you just kind of were inattentive for a second. Here, he's not supposed to be driving. Here, he knows he's a danger. Here, he knows he can have a heart attack. He's already had three. And yet he does it anyway. We would say he was reckless at this point. In North Carolina, I think he's probably chargeable with some level of homicide. Whether we're going to look at a... Now, North Carolina has classically six homicides. Let me back up. The six homicides, and we'll talk about these when we get to the homicides, but they're first-degree murder, which is that premeditated murder or murder that occurs during murder felonies. You have second-degree murder. You have voluntary manslaughter, involuntary manslaughter. You have felony death by motor vehicle and misdemeanor death by motor vehicle. I would say probably a conviction here is that felony death by motor vehicle. All right, a man puts beta blockers to reduce chance of having a heart attack. He has blocked arteries but elects not to have surgery. He has less energy. He doesn't like it, so he doesn't take it. On his way back from picking up his son and his son's roommate, he has a heart attack and wrecks the car. He kills the roommate as well as the driver the car hits. And you can see he's got a little less liability here. Maybe that last one would be a manslaughter charge. This one you might say, well, he had some danger, but was he really aware of it? Did it rise to the level maybe of involuntary manslaughter? Maybe the previous one, the one where he had lots of knowledge, would be a voluntary manslaughter charge. It's really going to be the presence or the absence of malice there. All right, number four. A man is driving to work early one morning while driving, has a mild heart attack and crashes. Three people are injured in the wreck, none are taken to the hospital, but one dies a week later. If you had no knowledge of this, if you just had this heart attack, I don't see where there's a criminal charge here. I would say that, you know, given this scenario, if he's driving, has a mild heart attack, and crashes, this is kind of a bolt out of the blue. There's no mens rea, right? There's no evil intent. There's no sinister. There's no recklessness. There's no extreme negligence. I don't think there's a criminal charge here. So you can see, looking at those those different scenarios, that, you know, they're same event. You could have a person dead in each one. And for some people, they'll say, well, it doesn't matter. Is a person dead? Someone needs to be charged. But we really are concerned, you'll notice, with the mental state of the person who did it. Did they do it intentionally like the first one? It's probably going to be a first-degree murder charge. Were they extremely reckless, maybe even malicious? Maybe on the second one. Maybe you got a... And it's going to vary from state to state. Like I said, we're going to look at... I don't want to introduce malice and intent as much here. We're going to look to see if that's a second-degree murder charge or whether it's a voluntary manslaughter charge. By the time we get to the third one, I think we're looking at maybe an involuntary manslaughter charge, maybe a felony death by motor vehicle. And by the time you get into this one, I don't think there's a criminal charge, because you've got someone who commits an act, but they were really unaware that this was going to happen. This is just something like a bolt out of the blue. Okay, well, that completes our lecture here of this chapter. And these are pretty important points. These are points that can vary greatly by state. And as we go deeper into this, one of the units that I'm going to be posting is some specific North Carolina law, which, frankly, I'm just more familiar with. So we'll talk about the murder felony rule there and a few things like that. And we'll talk about these homicide statutes, because we will get to them. We'll get to the six major homicide statutes in North Carolina, and we'll break them down and understand that better. But I hope this was good for you. I hope it helped you understand what's going on. And when you're ready, you should be able to, after I record it, go to chapter four. Have a good afternoon, good morning, or good evening.